Well, good morning and welcome to the Medina Church of the Nazarene. It's good to be here with you this morning. Our pastor, Pastor Pete, is out today, but we are privileged to have Pastor Will Browning here joining us, and we'll tell you a little bit more about him, and he'll be bringing us the message this morning. I'm Tyler Skidmore. I'm glad to be here. I've been here for a few months now as worship leader, and just have enjoyed getting to spend the Christmas, the Advent season here with everyone in worship, and I'm excited to be worshiping with everyone here today. We've got some exciting things in store for you, and I know that God will be glorified in that, and that's our hope and our prayer this morning. Our call to worship: sing a new song to the Lord, for he has done wonderful deeds. His right hand has won a mighty victory. His holy arm has shown his saving power. The Lord has announced his victory and has revealed his righteousness to every nation. He has remembered his promise to love and be faithful to Israel. The ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Shout to the Lord, all the earth. Break out in praise and sing for joy. Sing praise to the Lord with the harp and the melodious song, with trumpets and the sound of the ram's horn. Make a joyful symphony before the Lord, the King. We think about that word joy around the Christmas season. And I'm not sure if your day yesterday was joyful or not. It could have been a mix of things, a lot of different emotions. But we hope that you had a joyous Christmas. But we do know that ultimately that Christmas is about victory. It's about God with us, Emmanuel. And he is here with us this morning. And we're going to sing a familiar Christmas song that may be just a little different than how you remember it, but joy to the world. Would you stand and join us? Joy to the world.
Joy to the world.
Unspeakable joy,
joy, unspeakable joy, an overflowing well, no tongue can tell.
Joy,
unspeakable joy, it rises in my soul, never lets me go.
My soul never lets me go. joy to the world, right? Lots to be grateful for. And the as the angels sing, hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king.
Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity. Pleased as man with men,
Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Over the skies of Bethlehem appeared a star, while angels sang to lowly shepherds. Three wise men seeking truth traveled from afar, hoping to find the child from heaven. Falling on their knees, they bowed before the humble Prince of Peace. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring an offering to you. The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne. Before the Holy One of Heaven. But it's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. Oh Lord, I bring. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. Together. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be here the day after Christmas and what that represents, Lord. You're coming to earth. You're reaching out for us. As we just sang, there's no way we could even dare to approach you, but you reached out for us. You reached out for us. It's only by your blood and through your mercy, Lord, that we come here today, that we're here worshiping you 2,000 years later here in Northeast Ohio, here in Medina. We pray that you would just be in every aspect of this service, this gathering today. I pray that our hearts would be open to hearing from you, to learning something new or some new insight, Lord. I pray that you would just speak to us today and that we would be open to hearing it. I know we might be a little tired. We might have physical distractions and things that may be going on, but I pray that you would open us up to hearing from you today. I pray, Lord, for those who aren't here, those who are watching on the live stream today, and maybe those who aren't, whether it's for health reasons or travel reasons or whatever it might be, Lord, you know, and I pray that you would be especially near to those in need today. I pray for your healing, for those in need of your healing. I pray for spiritual healing. And I pray for change, for transformation, for those in need of that this morning, too. Thank you again for this opportunity to gather. Thank you for reaching out to us, for approaching us. And thank you for music that we can share together to corporately worship you and give you just that small little gift back. And we thank you for this day. In your name I pray. Amen. All right, you may be seated. So I'm here responsible for some announcements today, and I've got just a couple. There's really not a lot. A lot of the announcements kind of went out with this last week, and you know we were talking about the carols and cookies and the Christmas Eve service that we had and all of these exciting things happening through the holiday season. Well, you won't be disappointed in January. While it may be a little quieter for the next few weeks, there'll be lots of activity here for sure in January. I do know one big thing that I wanted to talk about, though, is that there are membership classes, and there's an opportunity for that. So if you are interested in joining the Church of the Nazarene or this specific Medina Church of the Nazarene, please reach out to Pastor Pete. There's information here in your bulletin, your worship folder this morning. And I believe he's planning to do those classes on Sunday morning. So looking at that in January. So please do reach out to him as soon as you can if you're interested in membership. Opportunities, ways to give. There are a lot of ways to give. There's a little box in the back if you'd like to give that way. Of course, you can do online. You can mail checks. You can do the text to give. That's pretty cool, too. There are opportunities to do that should you need to do that this morning. And we are excited to be joined by a guest speaker today. And there's your ways to give, too. Great. Our guest speaker this morning is Pastor Will Browning. And there's a little bit about him at the back of the worship folder. He's an Ohio native, but he is studying right now at Trevecca Nazarene University. He is a NCO district licensed minister. And he's studying religion with a focus on pastoral ministry at Trevecca Nazarene University in Nashville, Tennessee, and will be graduating this May. And his plan is to be a pastor of a local church. So exciting things. You got, I'm sure, a busy year up ahead of you, and we appreciate you joining us during this holiday time. I think there's a quick video, and then you'll hear today from Pastor Will Browning. No video? It's not my video anyway, so it doesn't matter to me. Well, we can just jump right into it then. How about that? Good morning, Medina. How we doing today? We doing all right? Well, Merry Christmas. You can keep saying that for about 11 more days. You've heard of the song 12 Days of Christmas. That is actually referring to the day of Christmas and then 12 days after Christmas. So keep saying Merry Christmas to people. Keep greeting people with Merry Christmas for these upcoming 12 days, because in the church calendar, we are still in the season of Christmas. And what a beautiful, beautiful season it is. Truly one of my favorites. I'm sure it's one of your favorites as well. That introduction pretty much sums up who I am. I'm from Mount Vernon. My mother works for the North Central Ohio Church of the Nazarene. My dad works at Mount Vernon Nazarene University. And I'm getting married in May. And so just a lot of things happening. Yeah, thank you. And so just a lot of things happening. And I'm so very grateful for my North Central Ohio District family, these opportunities that I get to speak. They just have shaped me and molded me into who I am today. And God has used those to help reveal this calling on my life to shepherd people, to help not save people, but point people in the direction of the Savior, somebody who can save, somebody who is able to save. And we're going to talk about him today, obviously, Jesus, Christmas time. But I first want to start off with this question. And you're going to need to talk to somebody around you. I don't know if you really like doing that on a Sunday morning. You might not want to talk to anybody around you. But I want you to talk to somebody around you. I'm going to set a timer, give you about 5 minutes. Nah, let's give 3 or 4 minutes, cut it a little short. It's not that difficult of a question. Just whatever pops into your mind when I say this one word, what comes into your mind, share it with somebody else. King. What does the word king bring to your mind? An image, a person, a characteristic. What comes to your mind when you hear the word king? So I'll just give you about 3 minutes, and I'm just going to stand up here, drink my water a little bit, and then we'll come back, and we'll get going from there. So what does king bring to your mind? Go ahead. Alrighty, I'm going to cut you a little short. I feel like that felt like enough time to kind of get us
a few good answers. So now, you're going to have to talk a little bit more. I want to know what some of your answers were. So the word king, what were some of the first things that popped into your mind? Ultimate authority. What was that? Oh, okay. Yeah, prom king. Yeah. No, that makes sense. David? Yep. Monarchy? Castle. Nice. Chess. Great one. That's a good one. I didn't think of that. That's good. King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Yep. Elvis Presley. There we go. That's a good one. I'm not talking about Elvis today, but I mean, that's a really, really good one. Yeah. Yeah. Something about your heritage. There's that line, that lineage of kings. Yeah, a dynasty almost, if you will. Yeah, so there's plenty of things that we can think of when we hear the word king. But if we are being who we say we are called to be, our idea of a king should be very different. The passage for today is the Christmas narrative. It's found from in Luke chapter 2, starting at verse 1. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinus was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house, the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel of the Lord said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those whom his favor rests." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. God, I thank you for sending your son. God, I thank you that you humbled yourself become flesh and blood, and that ultimately you would shed your flesh and blood for this broken world in which we live, for the hope of this world in which we live. Lead us now this day as we celebrate your birth, as we celebrate who you are as our King, our leader, our Messiah, our Savior, Emmanuel, God with us. We thank you for that today. It's in your precious name that we pray. Amen. So, it was mentioned the King David. And I'm kind of going to backtrack to the Old Testament real quick before I get back into the New Testament, the narrative of the birth of Jesus. Before King David even, before King Saul, the king before him, there was just the nation of the Israelites. These Israelites who, you know, they take their heritage all the way back to Adam and Eve, who ate of the tree, were kicked out of the garden, were wanderers, eventually leading to Abraham and Sarah, a landless man, a man who had no land, who had no worth, and a barren mother who could not bear children. And so therefore, in that time, she also had no worth. And God works in this, what seems like a irredeemable relationship. And this nation of Israel is born. This covenant is made. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars. What a promise that is to these two people that were probably very hopeless at this time. And so the nation of Israel grew. They refer to God as the God of Abraham and Isaac and of Jacob, the three fathers of the faith, if you will. And then ultimately, they find themselves captives in Egypt. They're captives. They're enslaved. They're worked so hard and so heavy. But God calls Moses. Tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And God frees them from Egypt. But then they are landless in the wilderness. They are wanderers. And they wander and they wander and they wander and they finally reach the promised land. And God gives them this land. And God came through on God's side of this covenant, this promise. God did it. God said God was going to do it, and God did it because God promised it. And that's what God does. God doesn't back out of a covenant that God makes. But being humans, sometimes we can back out of promises that we make. You know, in the wilderness, the people said, we'll follow the Lord forever because we want God's presence to be with us forever. God, don't abandon us, because if you're not with us, then there's no reason for us to even be here. And so God is with them. But then it comes to this point. We find ourselves in 1 Samuel 18. Where the people look at Samuel, the prophet, and say, we want a king. We want to be like all the other nations around us. Because their kings bring order, and they win battles, and there's great prosperity, and it seems so good. We want a king. We want an earthly king. We want somebody amongst us to rule over us. And Samuel's obviously hesitant. He goes, whoa, 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 whoa. Why do you want that? And they just say, we want a king. We want a king. Samuel goes to God and says, God, these people, they want a king. And God says, if they want a king, give them a king. But this king that they want so desperately will oppress them, enslave them, and be so very greedy with what God has blessed them with. They want a king, and God even warns them, it's almost going to feel like you're back in Egypt. This king will oppress you. This king will enslave you. This king will take your strong young men, lead them to battle to death, and take your young women and take them for his own. This king will do these things. And I can even like sense it almost in God's voice. Are you sure you want to do this? Are you sure about that? I know adults in my life have always asked me that. When I told my mom I wanted to be a pastor, she said, are you sure you want to do that? Because there is, you know, a lot of things that come with being a pastor. It's not the easiest job in the world. I mean, if you look at just statistics-wise, I say I want to be a pastor, but I see that less and less people are going to church. You go, Will, you're out of your mind. Why would you want to do that? But I know that God has called me to this. But when God says, are you sure you want to do that? You should probably take a step back and go, oh, I don't know. Am I sure I want to do that? But the people of God say, we want a king. God gives them a king. God gives them a king. And there's a whole lineage of kings. This lineage that we talk about. There's Saul, but then there's David and Solomon. And, you know, it keeps on going. It keeps on going. And it all seems all right throughout it. this relationship aspect. There is always God, who is the constant, who is divine, who is mediator over everything. And then there's us, and we fall short, and we sin. And sometimes we don't live up to our end of the bargain. But God, mysteriously, for whatever reason, chooses to redeem and restore and bring us back into relationship. And there's this cycle that just happens over and over again with the kings and God and the people, and it just keeps on going, keeps on going, keeps on going, until finally the prophets come along and they say, man, this is not good. We're going to lose all this land. We're going to be sent away. And the very thing that you asked for, you're not even going to have anymore. It's going to be taken from us. And it's inevitable. We just ended up on this path, and this is the destination where we are now. They end up in exile. People are, the word exile literally means to be stripped bare. In the Hebrew, to be stripped bare, and now the people are naked. They had all these things that were covering them up. They had the land that they kind of wore as a shirt. And they had the king they kind of wore as their pants. And they had the temple that they wore as their shoes. And they walked in these clothes that they had somewhat made idols for themselves. And now the exile comes along and they are stripped bare of those things. And they don't have a king. They don't have land. They don't have the temple. But God still promises, I am with you. Emmanuel, God with us. I am with you. They thought of a king as a military leader, as a great general. And as I was writing this sermon, I was in the middle, my family and I were in the middle of catching up on some of the Marvel movies to go watch the new Spider-Man movie that just came out. I hear this movie is fantastic, and the last time my family caught up was back in 2014, so we missed like 55 movies between now and then. And so we're catching up on all these movies, and I was sitting there, I was trying to, you know, multitask and write and watch at the same time, which is not a good idea. I don't know, I try it every single time, it never works out. But we're watching this movie in which there is this people and they no longer have a king. They're being ruled by this dictator, by this evil dictator who just rains death on everybody and crushes anybody that opposes her. And then there is this revolution, this king, Thor, who comes out and has this great power and overthrows her, and the people get away and they are free from this oppression. And all seems good until you watch the next movie and it just all goes crazy and it's not good. But at the end of that movie, you're like, yeah, like the king came and, you know, there was this revolution and it all happened so good and so big and all the CGI and it made it look so cool. And that's what a revolution should look like. That's what a king should do. There was this certain group of people before the time of Jesus that thought the Messiah that was prophesied in the Old Testament would look somewhat like that sort of king that would lead a revolution where there would be this great battle and they would overthrow the authorities and there would be, this great grand victory. And there would be bloodshed and loss and all the things that come with war. But then we read this story. The story that I just read. The story of Mary and Joseph, who were nobodies in the ancient world. They were nobodies. They're from Nazareth. Later in the Gospels, Nathanael asks, what good can come from Nazareth? That's what people thought of it. Nothing good can come from this place called Nazareth. But there's this baby who's born of a virgin lying in a manger. This baby is supposed to overthrow the authorities. This baby is supposed to lead this people into battle. We know Jesus. We can read all about Jesus' life, death, resurrection. We read all about it here. I don't read anything about some great revolution happening. I read about this God becoming man, laying his hands on people and healing them. Going out to those that the world hates, like tax collectors, and eating at their houses and saying, follow me. I guarantee you the people that thought this Messiah that was going to overthrow the Roman Empire, they thought he was no king at all. What sort of king doesn't lead people into battle? What sort of king is so giving of their time and resources? What sort of king does this? Church, it's our sort of king that does this. And it gives me such great hope that we serve a king that is not some bloodthirsty monster who just wants to send people to hell. But God, in our shortcomings, in our failings, continuously picks us back up and says, I'm redeeming, I'm restoring, I am making all things new. That's the king that we serve. We treat, and I'm guilty of this, sometimes we as the church, capital C, which means church universal, treat people outside of the church who we usually generalize as sinners, as the enemy of some sorts. And we need to beat them over the head with this book until they come to church, until they get saved, and then finally God can do a work in them. That's not how this works. If we do what we are called to do and be like Jesus, we are out there and we're not just telling them, get your butt in a pew or a seat in a sanctuary. We're saying, let me tell you that there is hope. Let me tell you about this healing that can take place. Let me tell you about the joy that comes in knowing our Savior. I think about all the opportunities that I could have had doing that, spending time with people at a lunch table where maybe they don't know. They just don't know. It's not that they're choosing not to know. They just don't know about this guy named Jesus, this triune God who saves. But me and my own insecurities, I pull myself back and I say, I'm just gonna wait till God does a work and then I'll step in. I'll step in after God does a work and then I'll be like, oh yeah, you met this guy? Man, I've known this guy my whole life. Let me tell you more about him. What would happen if we go, I see that you're hurting. I see your pain. I see that your relationship with your family is not what you want it to be. Little side note, I don't know why, but yesterday my heart was just extremely heavy thinking about my friends who have broken homes this holiday season and how difficult of a time yesterday could have been for them. they just took a text to a few people saying, I'm thinking of you and I'm praying for you today, that God would comfort you in this time. I don't wait for God to do a work and then I interject. I say, God, would you do a work through me? And God doesn't need us to do God's will, but God chooses to use us, church. God chooses out of his grace to use us for the saving of the world. That is a beautiful, beautiful thing. I think about my favorite Christmas hymn, O Holy Night. What a beautiful, beautiful song. I'm just gonna read some of the lyrics. And this is the sort of king that we serve. O Holy Night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and ever pining till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, a weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, O hear the angels' voices. O night divine, O night when Christ was born. O night divine, O night, O night divine. Chains he shall break, for the slave is our brother. And in his name, all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy, in grateful chorus raise we. With all within, let us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord, his name forever praise we. What sort of king do we serve, church? Merry Christmas. Our king is here. Our king brings us hope. Our king saves. But it's not just for us. It's not just for us, church. If we think it's just for us, we are doing a great disservice. I love this season so much. And I know this might not be the typical Christmas story that you're all used to, but I want to tell you today, the good news is, even if you haven't been perfect at doing this, like myself, I'm not perfect at doing this, God says, I'm redeeming you, church. In your shortcomings, I am redeeming you. I am restoring you. A good work is being done. Just open your eyes. Because sometimes when the church doesn't want to listen, when people like us don't want to make room, God goes to the hillside and calls the shepherds out in the field. Let's make room, church. Open our eyes to the things happening around us. Don't just wait for God to do a work, but pray that God would work within you. Because God wants to. God wants to do a work in you. And you know what God's work brings? Jesus promises this. A spirit of peace. And order. Not a spirit that brings division and destruction and death, but peace. Peace. God, as we are about to sing in this last song, You Are Our Hope. In a time where our world seems hopeless, God, would you give us the hope of the world, who is your Son? Will you give us a spirit of peace? Will you give us eyes to see and ears to hear what you're doing? God, would you do something so mysterious we had no idea it was going to happen? God, for those who've had a tough Christmas season because of the loss of a loved one, or a broken relationship, God, would you be near? Would you restore? Would you give hope? In the words of your Son, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. God, today, let us be that comfort to someone.
Thou didst leave thy throne and thy kingly crown when thou camest to earth for me. But in Bethlehem's home there was found no room for thy holy nativity. O Lord, with the living word that should set thy people free. But with mocking scorn and with crown of thorn, they bore thee to Calvary. O come to my heart, Lord. Room in my heart for thee.
Would you stand as we sing this next verse?
When the heaven shall ring and the angels sing at thy coming to victory, let thy voice call me home, saying, yet there is room at my side for thee. Shall rejoice, Lord Jesus, when thou comest and callest for me. How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. But in desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace, the God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven, and the King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came a morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Today, if you forget everything else I said, know that we serve a King who brings peace. Blessed are the peacemakers. We serve a King who brings hope, even through death on a criminal's cross. So I don't know if y'all do like benedictions or sendings around here, but I love the posture. If you would hold out your hands like this posture of receiving this blessing. May the God who was born of a virgin lived a life serving others, never self-seeking, this God who could have just came down from that cross, died. This God who 3 days later defeated death in the grave. This God calls us to love one another. But God is also calling the shepherds in the fields. God is doing a work. Open your eyes, church. And ask God, use me. So that one day, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of not just me, but of us. And know that any wrongs we make, any shortcomings we have, God will forgive us. But we need to make an effort to say, I'm sorry. Reconciliation amongst neighbors. We need it more than ever, don't we? We need reconciliation with our family members, with those on this side of the political spectrum or this side of the political spectrum, what you believe about vaccines, whether you should take it or not take it. We need reconciliation more than ever. God, give us a heart ready to reconcile. That's a dangerous task. Give us a heart of your Son. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Merry Christmas. Go in peace.